not mine. 2020, I can see the future. You're looking at me with your jealous eyes. Remember everything you forgot you were.
Welcome back to some of you, and it's about damn time to others. It's Anarchist Weapons Wednesday, and tonight we have the alphabetties turning thousands of previously law-abiding citizens into felons by the mere stroke of a pen. Reminding us all, of course, that the Constitution is in fact worthless. We have the Kiwis that are still standing so beautifully defiant in the face of tyranny. We have Salwell dipping out, but his draconian law dream lives on, and Chicago's 4th of July violence wasn't stopped by their gun laws. I know that's shocking. And of course, we cannot possibly forget our Florida man of the week. So let's go ahead and do that. All right. So first of all, courtesy of Ambler Law Offices, ATF decides to magically make a whole bunch more felons. So this is a cautionary tale of why the Constitution isn't truly compatible with freedom and how bureaucrats have bent the American people over yet again. That doesn't seem fair. This is the initial reaction of many gun owners when they hear that the ATF has once again changed their methodology when classifying different types of weapons. On July 5th, 2019, Adam Kraut wrote an excellent blog post for the Prince Law Office's blog where he detailed a letter that one of his clients had received. That letter right there. And the letter contains an ATF opinion that seemingly rearranges what will be classified as an AOW in any other weapon for the purposes of the National Firearms Act. I am altering the deal. Pray I do not alter it any further. got to throw one of my OC memes in there. But anyway, in brief, this letter basically explains that the ATF will no longer measure weapons that are equipped with braces, such as the SBA 3, the SBA 4. There's a few others. There's this is kind of a variation on the SBA 3 that's out there. Stuff like that. Basically, anything with a pistol brace is no longer going to be measured with the brace fully extended. Now, you may ask yourself, why is this a big issue? Well, if you have a weapon that is currently unregistered, such as this one, as an AOW under the NFA, if it only exceeds a 26-inch overall length, so that is from the end of the barrel, not the removable muzzle device. If the muzzle device is removable, it still doesn't count. From the end of the barrel to the end of, in this case now, basically the buffer tube. Or, if it's folding, the end of where it folds. So, this whole bit on the back here, up in that upper right corner of your screen, that is a pistol brace. That no longer counts if it's collapsible. So, basically what that means is if you have that gun, and up to this point, it's not needed to be registered under the NFA, you're a felon now. Abracadabra, you're a felon. Because now, they changed the rules on you. See, on rifles, the measurement used to determine the weapon's overall length, the OAL, has always been performed with the stock... With the stock fully extended. So everything pulled out. Similarly, in the past, the measurement of an extended brace was often used to inch what would otherwise have been considered a pistol over the ATF's magical 26-inch mark. This was a procedure that the ATF had previously indicated would be used by them to measure such a weapon. Once the weapon measured over 26 inches and absent evidence that the weapon was otherwise concealable, the vertical foregrip on the front could be added to the weapon without it falling into the NFA's AOW designation. Move that back to where it was. There we go. So how do we get here and what any of these terms mean? Well, included as part of the statutory definition of pistol is the description of a weapon designed to be fired with one hand, even though not a single damn person with any real experience with a pistol would ever actually fire one that way. It has to be designed to be able to be fired with one hand at a vertical foregrip, so a secondary grip up front, and it now becomes clear that the weapon is no longer designed to be fired with one hand. This means that once a pistol is outfitted with a vertical foregrip, it becomes classified as an NFA-controlled AOW, all other weapon. However, the definition of AOW, which excludes pistols, remember, designed to be fired with only one hand, covers impertinent part weapons that are capable of being concealed on the person. This is where that 26-inch overall length matters. As such, that they, As such, weapons, even when equipped with a vertical foregrip, which shows design intent, in that they are no longer designed to be fired with one hand, and thus no longer statutorily excluded as pistols, those were considered incapable of being concealed on a person. You couldn't stick them in a purse, right? You couldn't hide those. Absent any contrary evidence, so if somebody can prove that you can, in fact, hide it, it gets even murkier. But I'm trying to be simple here. So that was not covered by the NFA as an AOW. It is also worth explaining that braces, while sometimes appearing similar to stocks, are in fact designed to be fired as a one-handed weapon. So they are actually truly a brace. They're designed to strap around the outside of your forearm. So braces, therefore, are perfectly legal, even when shouldered, for the time being, anyway. I'll get to that in a minute. And don't make a pistol into an SBR, short-barreled rifle, which would, of course, be NFA-controlled, because it's designed to be fired from the shoulder at that point. In summary, what does this mean for gun owners? Arguably, anyone who has a weapon equipped with a brace that, when extended, measures over 26 inches, but when collapsed, measures under 26 inches, has effectively committed a federal felony if their weapon is, one, unregistered under the NFA, and two, equipped with a vertical foregrip. Penalties include the possibility of up to 10 years imprisonment. There is no indication of any kind of grace period from the change that this letter causes. So when this sucker came out, and you can see the date, June 25th, right there. When this came out, if you have an AR pistol and you have a foregrip, you're a felon automatically. That's a felony. But if you have a rifle with a vertical foregrip, that's acceptable. I realize this is probably really confusing, and that's because it is really confusing, because it's completely arbitrary. So how can the ATF say one thing, then on a whim and without mass notice to the public, change their mind? And remember, this isn't the first time this has happened. Let's go back, if you remember, to the first pistol brace debacle. If the extent of the rules coverage were to be relaxed, such as when the ATF reversed that language, on the largely untenable legal position that shouldering a weapon equipped with a brace magically made it an SBR. For those unfamiliar, what that means is that if I have a pistol brace, so what used to be their dictate, is if I had a pistol brace on my AR pistol and I fired it out here away from my shoulder, that's legal. The moment I put it against my shoulder, their opinion used to be that the moment that I did that, magically, that is now an SBR, because now I've shouldered the weapon. Now, that's completely legally untenable, and they have since reversed that. But that is something that they did by edict, and reversing it was also something they did by edict. Now, if they do that again, it becomes a non-issue in that it would mean fewer people would be facing criminal liability. Here, however, the ATF has potentially made thousands of gun owners into criminals by the stroke of a pen, and has their, you know, here the ATF, by changing how they measure weapons equipped with a brace, has potentially made thousands of people felons who never intended to be, who never intended to violate the law, who are just trying to do something. So the question is, under the Constitution, because I referenced that earlier, how does that work? Well, at its heart, this is administrative rulemaking. Remember the old films shown in school that describe legislative process? Those films always show the legislative branch making the law, the executive branch enforcing it, and then the judicial branch reviewing the laws to determine whether or not the executive branch should enforce them. Unfortunately, these films fail to describe administrative agency powers and their effect on rulemaking. See, the basic idea is that for the sake of efficiency, the legislature grants an agency, so the alphabetties, some authority, and that agency can use that power to create rules to assist in the enforcement of statutes, so long as they do not exceed the power granted to them by the legislature in the first place. For example, while the legislature defines what lengths and types of weapons may constitute a pistol versus generic firearm, the agency tasked with enforcement gets to come up with how to effectuate the measurement of the weapon. And while judicial review used to be a powerful check on agency power, the idea of the Chevron deference has in many ways undermined the check that the courts should have been. In 1984, the Supreme Court of the United States decided the Chevron case, and Justice Stevens, who does in fact want to take your Second Amendment rights away, proclaimed that, quote, judicial deference is appropriate where the agency's answer was not unreasonable, end quote. He also goes on to say, so long as the Congress had not spoken directly to the precise issue at question. While this type of deference has been narrowed in scope to what is now known as Skidmore deference, in the case of opinion letters from agencies, such as this case, the courts are still required to defer to an agency's determination of statute so long as it is deemed reasonable by the courts. This is what has led to a lot of the ongoing judicial battles that we see right now. Guys like the FPC, who I am involved in, the GOA, the the gun owners of the AR-15 gun owners of America, the FPL. There's a few others. The NRA, no, because the NRA sucks. They can bite me. But this is the heart of that, is that the ATF has, theoretically, under the Constitution, has the power to go, okay, well, the law says this, but the definitions aren't laid out in the law, therefore we get to decide what we're going to use. So if the law says your gun has to be 26 inches long, that's all it says. It doesn't say from this point to that point. The ATF gets to decide that because there is no law that says this is how it's measured. And a lot of that is the result of the way legislation works, where you have people who don't really understand guns trying to legislate on guns. Some of it is just the result of people assuming that things were obvious that become not obvious. I mean, look at the Second Amendment. The Founding Fathers were under the impression in the 1780s that this was a really obvious thing. And there was actually debate about whether or not the Second Amendment even was needed to be listed. However, it ultimately becomes a thing. So what is the end result? If gun owners wish to avoid problems and headaches, they should probably immediately remove vertical foregrips from any firearm that only reaches an overall length of 26 inches with the brace fully extended before they go to a range, at least a public range. Not that I would ever advocate anybody do anything illegal. However, if a gun owner does get jammed up on such an issue, you should really make sure that you contact somebody like the FPC in particular, somebody else who can give a spirited legal fight about whether an agency regularly changing their mind about how to measure a weapon is in any way considered reasonable. That's my take on the current brace thing. While technically constitutional, that the ATF did define that, I also do want to clarify, all gun laws are in fact infringement. All of them. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter what it's defining, what it's regulating. If it is a law on guns, it is an infringement. And it is that freaking simple. To go to, let's see, the chat here real quick, since I am live. Hey, that means I can actually interact with people, so that's kind of nifty. Yes, it is the police state. Matt, with cannons for everyone, yeah. Actually, what's really funny about that is the way that the law reads, if it's old enough, you can totally have it. Totally. It doesn't matter that it's a massive cannon. If it's black powder, dude, you can totally use it. So how fun would that be? Just be like, oh yeah, I'm gonna go to local range as long as they, you know, allow it. With a cannon. Loaded up with grape shot, let's do this. Boy, would that suck for the Boogaloo. Bunch of alphabetties show up and wind up getting blasted with a, like, a Civil War era cannon. Wipe out an entire stack. Explosive rounds. Yeah, and I agree. Chris says the change in the definition of the word regulated has fucked us over hardcore, and that's exactly it. Well-regulated in 18th century parlance actually meant well-maintained, properly equipped, if you will. So that's actually what that means, the phrase means. There's a book that I harp on all the time that I think everybody needs to pick up that's very expensive but absolutely worth it, called For the Defense of Themselves and the State. Absolutely phenomenal, very, very detailed, quite expensive, but absolutely worth it to have on hand, because what it will allow you to do is argue the intent of the Second Amendment very effectively, exactly what they meant and that they didn't mean. When they said well-regulated militia, they didn't mean a militia, like a National Guard that was tightly controlled. What they meant was the people who were well-trained and well-equipped. That's what they meant. Because America was never meant to have a standing army, like, at all. We were always meant to just citizen soldiers, an army for defense only. But now we veer gently to the south, and head to the land of the Kiwis. That's right, we're going to New Zealand, folks. Via reason, non-compliance, kneecaps New Zealand's gun control scheme. I'm busting out the Kiwi pig. That is one of my favorite graphics, man. I love my Kiwi pig. Anyway. Once again, responding to a horrendous crime by inflicting knee-jerk authoritarian restrictions on innocent people proves to be an ineffective means of convincing people to obey. I realize that's shocking. Specifically, New Zealand's government, or, as I rather like to call them, the Kiwi pigs. New Zealand's government, which also stepped up censorship and domestic surveillance, by the way, after the bloody attacks onto Christchurch Mosque earlier this year, is running into stiff resistance to new gun rules from firearms owners, who are slow to surrender their now prohibited weapons and will probably never turn them in. Mullen Labe, says the Kiwi. That's all me, man. That's all me. Isn't it beautiful? I love it. Officials really should have seen it coming. Quote, police are anticipating a number of people with banned firearms in their possession won't surrender them, the website Stuff reported at the end of May, based on internal government documents. As of last week, only around 700 total weapons had been turned over. There are an estimated 1.5 million guns, with an unknown number subject to the new prohibition on semi-autos, in the country overall. Traditionally relaxed in its approach to firearms regulation and enjoying a low crime rate, New Zealand has no firearms registration rule. That means authorities have no easy way of knowing how many guns are actually in circulation or who owns them. Now, I covered this, I believe, the last episode, so if you're unfamiliar with exactly what's going on there and what the Kiwi pigs position on that is, definitely after this is over, go back and check out last times. But, quote, these weapons are unlikely to be confiscated by police because they don't know of their existence. Again, Philippa Yazbek of Gun Control New Zealand admitted recently. She said, quote, "These will become black market weapons if their owners choose not to comply with the law and become criminals instead." I realize it's shocking, but yes, when you outlaw guns, only outlaws have guns. Yazbek's organization advocates registering all guns in private hands, but that won't help with gathering any of the guns already in the possession of owners who are appalled by the government's attack on the rights of innocent people. Government attacks, it's worth noting, that come in response to the crimes of one man who explicitly anticipated exactly this response. Quote, "I chose firearms for the effect it would have on social discourse," the killer wrote in a document he released to explain his crimes. Quote, "The gun owners of New Zealand are a beaten, miserable bunch of baby boomers who have long since given up the fight. When was the last time they won increased rights? Their loss is inevitable. I just accelerated things a bit." He knew that this would be exactly what they were going to do. He knew that it would happen. He watched it happen every time there's any kind of a shooting-involved tragedy in the United States. He watched exactly this happen. He knew that's what was going to happen, and so he did what he did to inspire that. And you'll notice he talks about them in probably the same kind of way that I talk about the NRA. Now, thankfully, in the United States, we have other organizations, and thankfully, in New Zealand, they do still have they're Molin Labe Kiwis. Kiwi Labe? I don't know. I tried for a pun there. Politicians fulfilled the murderers' predictions with panic-driven legislation. The gun owners would, in large numbers, defy restrictions should have probably been anticipated by anybody who knows the history of government's attempts to disarm their subjects. Or anyone who even just glanced across the Tasman Sea to Australia. Quote, "In Australia, it is estimated that only about 20% of all banned self-loading rifles have been given up to the authorities," wrote Franz Szaszer. I have no idea. C-S-A-S-Z-A-R. I have no idea. A professor of criminology at the University of Vienna, after Australia's 1996 compensated confiscation of firearms, which followed a mass murder in Port Arthur, Tasmania, went into effect. Cesar put the number of illegally retained arms in Australia between 2 and 5 million. Quote, "Many members of the community still possess gray market firearms because they did not surrender these during the 96-97 gun buyback," the Australian Criminal Intelligence Commission conceded in a 2016 report. Quote, "The Australian Criminal Intelligence Commission continues to conservatively estimate that there are more than 260,000 firearms in the illicit firearms market." This is after, what is that, 96 to 2019. So 23 years? After 23 years, there's still more than 250,000 at a conservative estimate floating around in Australia that no one's willing to surrender. Just as Australian police named outlaw motorcycle gangs, this is a quote from them, "outlawing motorcycle gangs, Middle Eastern organized crime groups, and other groups engaged in trafficking illicit commodities such as drugs, as beneficiaries of the prohibition-fueled black market in firearms, underground organizations are similarly poised to prosper in New Zealand. Gangs in the island nation announced very loudly after the new legislation was introduced that they wouldn't be surrendering their own weapons." Will gangs get rid of their weapons? No. One prominent gang leader told Stuff, "Because of who we are, we can't guarantee our own safety." So, Kiwis who actually do comply with the confiscation scheme will put themselves at a noted disadvantage relative to violent gangs that have absolutely no intention, I realize that's shocking, to obey. They would also be putting themselves at a disadvantage relative to their own government, which is retaining its own weapons, despite a distinct lack of competence. In April, a police station provided one-stop discount gun shopping for an enterprising burglar, and intends to further squeeze the country's liberty. even before the latest law has been fully implemented. Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern is planning more gun legislation, including registration. Additionally, the Security Intelligence Service stepped up domestic spying after the mosque attacks and conveniently saw a big boost in its funding courtesy of the latest budget. But that's not suspicious at all. Arguably, defiant gun owners are just being realistic and seeing little to gain by obeying restrictive laws that have the greatest impact on those who pose no threat to their own neighbors. Fulfilling internal police expectations, some Kiwis openly boast of defying the law, especially with compensation rates for the buyback set well below the value of the firearms that are supposed to be surrendered. The low turn-in numbers suggest they're matching their words with actions. And who can claim to be surprised? By refusing to comply with restrictions, New Zealand gun owners are just following in the footsteps of their counterparts in Australia, Europe, specifically like Germany, Switzerland, France, Spain, Romania, and, of course, America. If New Zealand's, in each of those places, and many more besides that, gun owners have ignored laws, kept their property out of sight, and then completely frustrated all of the efforts to disarm them. If New Zealand's political class had looked to the history of gun control efforts, they would have seen that they were walking a already well-trodden path that leads to a dead end. Revolution. But then again, if they had enough foresight to know that restrictions on personal liberty are counterproductive and usually breed rebellion, probably wouldn't be in government in the first place. And now we move on to a happier tone. Well, not necessarily happier than the Kiwis being awesome, but Eric Salwell has halted his White House bid 3 weeks after his gun control mega plan. Polling low among the Democratic pack of 2020 presidential hopefuls, Eric Salwell, who looks, it really has to be said, suspiciously like Jeffrey Dahmer. Just saying. Dropped out of the race just weeks after announcing an extremely aggressive gun control plan. On Monday, the San Francisco area congressman threw in the towel on his campaign, becoming the first candidate in the incredibly crowded Democratic presidential primary to end his bid for the White House. With two dozen fellow Dems crowding Salwell out of the limelight and poll numbers hovering in the bottom of his peers, the California progressive said this week that he could, quote, no longer see a path forward to the nomination. However, Salwell did go on to say that he has won a victory of sorts in the respect that, quote, at the debate, three top-tier candidates embraced my idea to ban and buy back every single assault weapon in America. Just 3 weeks ago, in front of the headquarters of the NRA in Virginia, Salwell debuted his national framework to end gun violence to a fairly small crowd. The 65-point, 3,100-word plan is incredibly wide in scope. His proposals included a ban and buyback on many types of semi-automatic firearms, as well as adding layers of additional red tape to gun and ammunition manufacturers and retailers. It also would have required lawful gun owners to be licensed, registered with the government, and seek additional training under threat of prosecution, i.e., if you don't go out and get training for your gun, you get thrown in a cage. At the time, national gun control organizations, including Everytown, i.e. one of the mad cows, applauded Salwell's proposal, with John Feinblatt, the Bloomberg-supported group, saying, quote, Rep. Solwell's new gun safety platform is the latest evidence of preventing gun violence will be a key issue in the 2020 campaign, end quote. Nonetheless, in the month following his gun plan, the performance at the first Democratic debates, being what it was, Solwell dropped even lower than his previous 19th place ranking in the polls, putting him in danger of being excluded altogether anyway from the second set of debates. With Solwell absent moving forward, though, fellow Dems with an eye on the White House next year thanked him for his anti-gun talking points, and many vowed to carry on with the same message. This predictably included Massachusetts Senator Liz Warren, who said, you're a great fighter for the people of California. We are a strong nation because of your work to protect our children and our communities from gun violence. Sorry, that was Kamala Harris. Wow. All right. Well, Kamala Harris. Cory Booker. Thank you, Eric Solwell. Grateful for your public service and your leadership on working to end gun violence in our communities. I look forward to continuing to work together on this urgent issue and more. Booker can go straight to hell. I hate that guy. Let's see here. Amy Klobuchar. Thanks, Eric Solwell, for your good work, and I know that you will continue to be a national leader to end gun violence, speak truth to power, and so much else. Don't mind me, I just had to vomit a little bit after having read that. Here's Liz Warren's. She said, thank you, Eric Solwell, for your commitment to making gun reform front and center in this election. Gun violence is a public health crisis, and I'll keep fighting alongside you for a safer future. The American people are lucky to have you in this fight. Was that insensitive? Let's be honest, I don't fucking care. Speaking of hoplophobic idiots, let us go to Chicago. Yes, I know, this is a reasonable response to being asked to go to Chicago. Quote, our city deserves better, Police Superintendent Eddie Johnson says. Another long holiday weekend, another slew of shootings in Chicago. I know, it's shocking. Last week, Mayor Lori Lightfoot, seen here, had outlined her plans for dealing with the expected surge of summer holiday violence. In all, an extra 1,500 officers were being put on the street. The result, however, were worse than last year, with the same number of fatalities and even more wounded, according to the Chicago Police Department. Lightfoot discussed the weekend after another of her Accountability Monday meetings with police at City Hall. Earlier in the day, CPD Superintendent Eddie Johnson, dude on the right there, had blamed repeat gun offenders for much of the violence. Let that sink in. Repeat gun offenders. Lightfoot agreed and said CPD must communicate better with courts, quote, particularly about the necessity of keeping these violent gun offenders off the streets. According to Johnson, from 6 p.m. Wednesday until midnight Sunday, 42 shooting incidents occurred, leaving 66 wounded and 6 dead. Last year, there were only 29 shooting incidents, 31 wounded and 6 dead during the holiday weekend. Johnson said, of the 42 gun arrests made between Wednesday through Friday last week, 18 were of repeat gun offenders. That's got to stop, the mayor said. Quote, we can't keep our community safe if people just keep cycling through the system, because what that says to them is, I can do whatever I want. I can carry whatever I want. I can shoot up a crowd and I'm going to be back on the street. How does that make sense? End quote. Lightfoot also called for common sense background checks and federal legislation to stop people from purchasing unlimited quantities of military-grade weapons across the state line in Indiana. Many of the gun-related incidents this past weekend, including 84 people arrested on gun-related charges Wednesday through Sunday by Chicago police, were carried out by people already familiar to the police. Quote, "We know that these offenders are likely to continue their behavior that landed them in handcuffs in the first place," end quote, said Johnson. Quote, "We know this because we keep arresting them over and over again." So what you're telling me is that they're already prohibited from owning firearms and get busted with firearms, and then are even more prohibited from having these, and then they do it again because laws against owning guns don't work for criminals. But Johnson also said statistics can't reflect the lives saved by Chicago police while recovering guns or arresting individuals. The 84 gun arrests made over the weekend, Johnson said, also are 84 times when, quote, those police officers took a weapon off of somebody that could potentially be a violent situation. Violence over the weekend was concentrated in the west and south sides of the city. The Englewood Police District had the most incidents with 5 shootings, followed by the Deering District with 4 and the Harrison, Near West, and Austin districts with 3 each. The challenges that we're seeing in our neighborhoods are not just a challenge of investment or lack of investment. They're a challenge of lots of different things that boil up and manifest themselves as violence, Lightfoot said. I can send 10,000 officers to the west side, and if we don't address the underlying challenges, which we must, we're not going to solve the conflict. The challenge going forward for Chicago police, Johnson said, is how to stop repeat offenders, especially in the face of gang involvement in certain areas. As a black man who grew up in public housing in the city of Chicago, I understand the stranglehold the gangs have on certain neighborhoods because I lived it, Johnson said. I also understand the struggle, challenges, and lack of opportunities when you grow up in certain neighborhoods in Chicago and if you look a certain way, he added. But despite all that, there's still no excuses or justified reasons for carrying the guns in the city. None. Really? None? Can't think of one reason you might want to be armed in Chicago. Like 66 people shot and 6 dead at one weekend. Yes, sounding like maybe weekends, quote, like this one are ones that we cannot continue to see, Johnson said. Our city deserves better. Now, let us be clear here. I absolutely agree that every firearm out of the hands of a violent street gang is a good thing. However, Johnson's also part of a violent street gang. So, still applies to him, too. I also definitely concur that the underlying issues that caused the gangs in the first place are what needs to get fixed, rather than just more gun laws and throwing people in cages. I absolutely do applaud his ability to see that at least there's a glimpse of the bigger cause here. However, what makes Johnson so blindingly obtuse is that they continue to think that the government intervention is the answer. They continue to delude themselves into this narrative that if they just ban harder, if they just pass more laws, if they just tax people at ever greater rates to redistribute as they see fit, this time it will work. Government is not the answer to any of these issues, and indeed, in the case of Chicago's gun violence problem, it is the original and ongoing cause. Draconian gun laws that are, in fact, even more strict than they were under the former Soviet Union are obviously not keeping guns out of the hands of criminals, given that we're talking about mostly repeat offenders here. Section 8 housing doesn't help. Welfare doesn't help. Caging them, caging thousands and thousands of inner city fathers, husbands, sons, the providers, and ripping them from their families for years because they dare to have a forbidden substance or buy and sell things outside of what the government wants isn't going to improve anything. Police presence never helps the situation for very long. You only fix the issues government is causing by removing the cause. Until that's done, and time passes after it's done, you'll never see the recovery that you long for. And make no mistake, again, government is the cause. It is the root. The poverty that you see in inner city Chicago is a direct result of government. The sons being ripped away, the fathers being ripped away, the destruction of these otherwise potentially nuclear families is a result of drug policies that are based largely on racism and desperation. And yet we continue to see these same bits of insanity over and over and over again. And instead of walking any of this back, they double down on all of it. Until they figure out exactly what's going on and that they're the cause, which they won't, it's just going to keep being bad. And you're just going to keep needing to mount up like Crazy Ivan. Who actually has a lot of guns that I'd really love to own myself. But now, if I had a drum, I'd give you a drum roll. It is time for our Florida Man of the Week. Florida Man. This week, Florida Man tries to steal 26 cars from Pasco jail parking lot just after he was released. Another day, another extraordinary Pasco man story. This is quoted directly from the Tampa Bay, I believe Tampa Bay, newspaper. Just after 68-year-old Dennis Libinati was released from the Lando Lakes jail Monday night, deputies say he was captured on surveillance video attempting to steal 26 different vehicles in the parking lot of the jail he was just released from. Deputies say the surveillance video showed Libinati going from vehicle to vehicle in a restricted area, pulling on door handles, all of which were locked. The video also showed that Libinati attempted to steal two sheriff's vehicles, according to his arrest affidavit, with him successfully entering the bed of a Dodge Ram pickup and then hotwiring a Kawasaki Mule ATV used by deputies. Dude got a little desperate. The Pasco County Sheriff's Office said Libinati was arrested just after 10:30 p.m. and charged with 27 auto burglary counts and one count of grand larceny. He had been locked up since mid-March on a trespassing charge, which he incurred 11 days after being charged with battery and then released. So the guy gets in a fight, goes to jail, gets out, manages to last a week, trespasses, goes back to jail, sits there for a couple of months, gets back out, and immediately tries to steal a whole bunch of cop cars. Upon detaining him, Libinati admitted to deputies he attempted to enter the vehicles, quote, with the intent to steal one to use for his own transportation, the affidavit says. Oh, well, I mean, if you needed a ride, by all means, just steal my car. The arrest circumstances may sound a little familiar to some people because another Florida man was arrested in November for doing exactly the same thing. Also, by the way, in Pasco County. Libinati, an upstate New York native, was immediately brought back into the same jail he was released from without any incident. He remained there as of last Thursday morning. I don't have any updates after that. But that is your show for today. It was the Weapons Wednesdays. every other Wednesday. Please make sure that if you do like this, that you do hit the like button. I'd appreciate it. Share with your friends, especially if you have a bunch of hoplophobic anti-gun friends, because, you know, that would be cool. Do be aware this is also available after I upload it, after this live video ends, on YouTube. Should be available within less than an hour, the full video, and as well as being available here on my Facebook page. Make sure that you check us out on Sunday night live when we do the Anarchy Among Friends roundtable discussion. It's always a good time. It's always interesting. We talk about everything anarchy related, and we are hilarious. The most professional show on the YouTubes. Also, one last thing. Make sure you check out my sponsor, LibertyTees.com, which is where I got this sweet Aaron Burr Tactical Pistol Solutions t-shirt. I will throw a link in the comments, timestamped for this timestamp, to this t-shirt if you're interested in grabbing it for yourself. That is all I have. As usual, stay safe, stay real, laugh to heal, all that fun stuff. You guys have a good night. Yeah, buddy. I love that thing.